So I don't want to disappoint you right off the bat, but I'm not Albert Einstein. Obvious, I know, but I felt that important to get out of the way early because I am going to compare myself to him in one small yet important way. But I think this comparison with Albert Einstein could be made with every scientific-minded person in this room, and even with young children who don't even yet know what a scientist is. You see, a lot of times we do science for a purpose. It puts cell phones in our pockets, roofs over our heads, satellites in the sky. But a lot of times we do science just because it's fun. Its eventual purpose might not yet be known, but we do it because it's interesting and cool. When a third grader mixes water and cornstarch to make oobleck for the first time, they're probably not wondering how the viscous forces of non-Newtonian fluids may somehow solve all of the world's problems. Of course not. They're thinking, this goopy stuff's pretty fun to play with, and I wonder what would happen if I poured it over my brother's head. In 1917, Albert Einstein published his paper on the quantum theory of radiation. Decades later, this work would lead to our understanding of light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation, otherwise known as lasers. Lasers have given us countless applications from medical procedures to the handheld devices that scanned your ticket to get you into the room this afternoon. But in 1917, Albert Einstein wasn't thinking, I'm going to make a QR scanner for my iPhone. He was thinking, hey, this light stuff's pretty cool. Let me play around with it for a little bit. I had one of those moments when I was getting my PhD right here at The Ohio State University, when I created the marching band's famous Script Ohio out of nothing but DNA, earning myself a Guinness World Record, which by my count is one more than Albert Einstein has. A lot of people ask me why I did it, or what does it do? My answer is always the same, because it was a lot of fun and the Buckeyes are awesome. It does serve one unintended purpose, however, which is to get non-scientists excited about this field and to share with them its capabilities. If I had titled this talk the same title of my PhD research, a dynamic DNA origami device for measuring compressive depletion forces, I'm not sure how many of you would have bought tickets. But with something like a scientist march of Script Ohio, especially here in Columbus, suddenly I have your attention. The field I'm excited about is known as DNA origami. You might be thinking to yourself, I know what DNA is, and I know what origami is. What in the world is DNA origami? Origami is the Japanese art of folding paper into shapes and figures. DNA origami is the science of folding DNA into mechanisms and machines. When people think of DNA, they naturally think of genetics. It's the stuff inside my cells that makes me unique. It gives me my blonde hair, my blue eyes, and is the reason I'm not tall enough to ride on most roller coasters. Structurally, DNA is in the shape of a twisted rope ladder that we call the double helix. The rungs of that ladder are a pair of molecules that we refer to as bases, and these bases can be either A, T, C, or G. Yes, they carry genetic information. But for DNA origami, this is just our construction material. The DNA is like our brick and mortar. It's our steel and concrete. Like paper, DNA is foldable. But unlike paper origami, DNA origami can create machines that have the potential to cure cancer. So why do we use DNA as our construction material? The first reason is because of its size. DNA is at the nanoscale, which is 1/1,000,000,000th of a meter. Typical origami structures have dimensions of about 100 nanometers, which is smaller than the wavelength of visible light. And that's important because we want to use these machines to investigate biological systems, so we need them to be at the appropriate scale. If I asked you to tell me how far it is from your house to your office, you're probably not going to use a ruler to figure out that information. And it's equally unlikely that you're going to give me that answer in light years. The same is applied here. If I want to know the forces being applied by a cell, I'm probably not going to use my bathroom scale. The second reason we use DNA is because it actually self-assembles. We don't do any of the folding. We just design the DNA so that it folds itself. A lot of people have a misunderstanding of how self-assembly works. They imagine putting a bunch of car parts into a box. If I were to shake that box up for a really long time, what are the odds that eventually I could open that box and find a fully functioning automobile engine? Zero. That's Zero. That's not how self-assembly works. Right? A better way to think about it is how ants make themselves into an ant bridge to get around objects in nature. There's no ant foreman with the hard hat on, leading the construction efforts, telling the other ants what to do. Right? Instead, every ant just follows a very simple set of rules. Grab onto the ant in front of me and hang on to the ant behind me. DNA self-assembly works in a very similar, simple set of rules. Any student that's ever taken a biology course is taught the rules that A can only bind to T and C can only bind to G. We can use this to get DNA to create the double helix on its own. Imagine I start with a single-stranded piece of DNA, which is one half of that rope ladder cut lengthwise. As long as I know the sequence, I can create a second sequence following that rule, where everywhere where there's an A, I put a T, everywhere where there's a C, I put a G. We would refer to these two strands as being complementary to one another, and they like to stick together like Velcro, zip up into that double helical shape automatically. DNA origami works through a clever application of this ATCG binding rule. Origami structures are made of two primary components. The first is the top image here, which we call the DNA scaffold. It is one long loop of single-stranded DNA that's typically thousands of these bases in length. Think about it like the scaffolding of this building. The second component on the bottom here is what we refer to as the staples. The staples are also single-stranded pieces of DNA, but they're much shorter, typically about 50 to 60 bases in length. And these are like the nuts and bolts that keep this scaffolding upright. The staples are designed to be piecewise complementary to the scaffold. What that means in this example here is the red section of the staple wants to bind to the red section of the scaffold, blue to blue, and green to green. Now, as it's drawn up here, that's not possible, because those spots are far apart from each other on the scaffold. The only way for that staple to fully bind to its complement is for the scaffold to fold itself up into some new shape, bringing those once distant spots closer together. This is a very simple example using one staple, but to make our complex structures, we use hundreds of unique staples in each design. DNA origami was first introduced in 2006 by Dr. Paul Rothman, where he showed the ability to use this science to create shapes like stars and smiley faces. When I joined the field in 2011, structures had become much more complex and even had inherent movement. My device here, my research was focused on creating force sensors that measures the forces in biological systems. I was giving a presentation on this work, and like any good Buckeye, one of my slides had the marching band script Ohio, and a student raised his hand and almost casually said, "Hey, you should make that out of DNA." There goes 3 years of my life. Okay. Here is the original sketch when I first sat down and thought about how can I approach this design problem. My plan was to just break it up into different sections and design it one section at a time. I started with one long straight rod of DNA origami. And the plan was to get that rod to bend and curve into the cursive shape of Ohio. That original rod I started with was 192 tokens in length. A token is like the base unit of measurement in DNA origami. Think about it like the length of a single cinder block, whereas you would need multiple cinder blocks to create something bigger, like a wall. The reason I tell this part of the story is because of a unique thing that happened. After I had started the design, a friend of mine gave me the actual blueprint of the football field that the marching band uses to create their Script Ohio. And I looked down and smiled when I learned that the Script Ohio is made from a single file line of 192 band members. That's one band member per one brick of origami. So I had the plan, but now I had to get something to want to bend on its own. Fortunately, I'm an engineering graduate and I know how bending works. Imagine you take any material, like a small section of a coat hanger, and you give it a little bit of a bend. What you're doing is introducing stress into that material. Stress is when we stretch and squish things. And like human beings, materials don't like to be stressed out. What do you do when you're stressed out? You release that stress by going to your happy place. Okay? Materials work the same way. When I release that coat hanger, it wants to release its stress by going to its happy place, its original straight shape. A rod of DNA origami would behave the exact same way. But to get something to want to bend, I just think about that problem in reverse. I design it so that when it's straight, it's stressed. And I do that by adding too much DNA in some spots and not enough DNA in other spots. And so when I release it, that straight rod wants to release its stress by going to its happy place, its curved shape, the different angles of the script Ohio. So I finished my design, and I ordered the DNA, and I started the folding reaction. The folding reaction involves putting all the ingredients into a tube, heating it up to really hot temperatures, and letting it cool down over the time frame of about 6 hours. Because I'm a proud nerd and a huge Buckeye fan, I played the fight song in the lab the entire 6 hours. That's not a joke. People eventually got upset. So the reaction was complete, and I took a sample to the microscope. The sample comes on a 3-millimeter copper grid. Now, 3 millimeters sounds small, but not when you're zoomed into the nanoscale. Imagine being zoomed in really close on Google Earth. You can scroll around endlessly and seemingly get nowhere. And that's what I had to do. Scroll around, looking for my needle in a haystack, literally day after day for hours at a time, sitting by myself in a dark microscope room, until eventually and finally, there it was. A 1 to 466 millionth scale replica of the Ohio State Marching Band's famous script Ohio, made entirely out of DNA and dubbed officially amazing by Guinness World Records. The DNA script Ohio was my oobleck. It was my version of playing around with light. But what are the lasers of DNA origami? What are the potential applications? A very exciting area of research is in targeted drug delivery for the use in curing cancer. I'm sure there's not a person in this room that doesn't know someone that's been impacted by cancer. And every day we're making incredible strides towards a cure. The problem with some of our current treatments, however, is sometimes they don't kill enough of the healthy cells. And other times, they kill too many, they don't kill enough of the cancerous cells, and other times they kill too many of the healthy cells. DNA origami has the potential to solve both those problems. For example, friends and colleagues of mine right here at Ohio State have created a device called the horse that is modeled after the Trojan horse, where soldiers hid inside of a horse ready to breach the walls of Troy. I know what you're hoping, but no, it does not look like a horse. It is this size and shape for a reason. Okay? You see, sometimes when we give cancerous drugs to cancerous cells, they spit them out before they can make their way to the nucleus to kill the cell. This is the size and shape that cells like to gobble up and bring into their nucleus. You'll also notice that it's hollow along its length in 4 spots, a perfect hiding spot for cancerous drugs. It will approach the walls of the cell, get brought in through the membrane into the nucleus, where the DNA breaks down, delivering its payload and killing the cell. And the best part is structures like these have the potential to be able to float around a cellular environment and ignore every single healthy cell and only attack its target. How would this horse know what its target is? Because like all cells, cancerous cells express genetic information in the form of unique and known sequences of A's, T's, G's, and C's. And because this horse is made of DNA, it could recognize and stick to its target like Velcro, ready to breach the walls. When I graduated, I became an engineering professor at Otterbein University. Every single day, I'm continued to be excited and inspired by science, and I've made it my life's mission to share that inspiration with others. My current research is making DNA origami experiments for middle school, high school, and undergraduate students. When people hear about this work, they think it takes a $100,000 laboratory and an army of research scientists to do DNA origami. But what we have shown is all that it takes is equipment that you could find in most middle school science classrooms, a $1 jug of distilled water you can buy at the grocery store, and a handful of excited sixth graders. The plan is simple. Show them something cool and let them have some fun. Make your oobleck, play with light, build your DNA script Ohio. Someday, someone might come along and use what you've learned to cure cancer. Thank you.